You join me at a stunning Shatterford Lakes. I'm actually fishing Masters Lake here today, and I'm going to run you through a few little tips on how to feeder fish lakes just like this one. Well, the bait I've brought for today's session, I've got a bit of a mixture, but that's for a reason, because I'm really hoping to aim for the big bream that is in this lake, but you never know with the water being very cold. So I've brought myself a nice little selection. Most important thing today is ground bait. Now I've mixed 50-50 F1 black and match method black. Now I've gone for the black reason because the water is very, very clear on this lake. So if you're going to a venue which is really clear, just aim towards the black ground bait, especially in the winter. So I've mixed it on the dry side, but I can always dampen that down as I'm going. Just to, you know, just depends on what I think on the day, really. So that's the ground bait. Another brilliant bait, as we all know, 2mm pellets. I've just soaked these for probably like a minute because the water is really, really cold. Just done about a pint and a half of them. And I'm going to be putting them through the feeder with the ground bait. Now, a really important bait is when you're going to lakes such as Masters Lake at Shatterford, is sweet corn. You know, if you go to a venue and you know there's big bream in there or big skimmers, then corn can be deadly. Because sometimes if you go to a lake and you need a big weight, instead of fishing with maggots and you're getting maybe ragged out by a little roach, you can just fish a bit of air rig corn. So I'm going to be putting this through with me ground bait and me micros. Now, I've also brought some sort of traditional baits, if you like. I've brought some casters, because obviously I'm going to aim basically to start for the bream, but if it's very hard and I can't catch, I might have to start putting some particle baits through, such as casters. So I've brought myself a pint and a half of casters. I've also got some fluoro pinkies. As we all know, if you go to a venue and there's skimmers, roach, you know, and you're trying to get bites, putting a fluoro pinky on, or double fluoro, or even three or four fluoro pinkies sometimes can be a great bait. So they're the change baits, really. And I've also brought the good old dead maggot. I've just got some red and white maggots in there. Keep them in the water, keeps them nice and soft. And that's it, really. Like I said, I've brought the three sort of traditional baits, casters, pinkies and maggots, just in case the fishing is really, really tough and I can't catch the bream. But my three main baits today is the ground bait, micros and the corn. Just going to go through the setup that I'm using for today. I'll start off with the reel. This is a 520 centris, absolutely bang on. I'm fishing quite a distance today, so try and aim for like a 520 size reel. On there, I've actually got 5 pound sinking mono, but I've got an 8 pound shock leader. And what I'll do, I'll show you how to do that a bit later on in the session. Another really important thing when you're feeder fishing is your feeder rod. I've got an 11.6 Sapira, absolutely bang on, can cast a big feeder a long way, especially with that 8 pound shock leader. Down to the business end, all I've got on there, obviously this is 8 pound because this is part of my shock leader. I've got a little paternoster on there, probably like a 4 inch paternoster. It's one of my favorite ways of fishing. If you're allowed, obviously if you've got a fish a running feeder, then the setup would just be slightly different. And all I've got on there, like I said, that's 8 pound. On the loop that actually attaches the feeder, I've got a snap swivel, so I can quickly change my feeder size, feeder weights, you know, nice and simple stuff. And then down to the business end, the hook size, at the moment I've got a piece of air rig corn on there, and that's attached to 015 power line and a size 16 KKM hook, because there's barbless hooks here at Masters Lake. And that's it, nice and simple. If I hold that up, at the moment I'm probably fishing like an 18 inch hook length, and I'm starting to try and catch the bream if I can. So I'm going to put quite a lot of bait out with a bigger feeder. So I'm going to turn around and I'll show you exactly how I've attacked this peg. Whilst I'm waiting for my first bite, I'm just going to go through feeder choice because it's really important. That's what I'm actually using at the moment. That's called a distance cage feeder. They're absolutely brilliant. Because as you see from that, all the lead is around the bottom of the feeder, so it's equally distributed. They're absolutely brilliant for casting. Now that's a cage feeder. They're really, really good. You know, you can compact these with ground bait really hard, but you are going to get some ground bait come out as that goes down through. So if you're trying to make a bit of a cloud, they're absolutely brilliant. Obviously they all come in different sizes, different weights. So if you're casting a long way, I'm fishing a 30 gram feeder today, but they do go to sort of 40 grams. The next feeder, this is called a plug it feeder. for a reason, because that middle bit there is solid plastic. So what you can do with that, if you're using lots of chop worm, lots of, you know, small baits like casters, pinkers and things like that, you can actually put that in the middle and then plug both ends with ground bait. Once again, they come in different sizes, different weights, but if you're putting a lot of particles in, they're absolutely brilliant. The next feeder is this Dutch Master bullet feeder. Now these, they're not really easy to load up, but if you're chucking a long way or you're struggling with a headwind, get the bullet feeder out. These fly like a bullet. That's why they're called a bullet feeder. If you're casting a long way or you're struggling to get out where you're fishing, get a bullet feeder on. They're absolutely brilliant. So those three cover me for all my feeder fishing on venues such as this one. I've just had my first bite. It's taken about 45 minutes. I've put 20 feeder falls in it to start, so I have attacked it. And this is what it's all about, is getting your first bite. You know, it's a bit of a bottle job really when you put that amount of bait in, but when you're fishing for big bream, especially on deep waters like this, putting amount of bait in, I put some corn in. I actually sat there a bit on air rig corn. I thought, no, I'll just change over to double maggot. So I've gone down to a 16 PR 412, a little bit longer at length. I was fishing a foot. I've probably got about a 2 foot at length on now. And it's been out there for about 10 minutes. Lovely bite. And I think it's either a bream or a big skimmer. But what a result really, you know, after, and you know, normally when you get your first bite, you can carry on catching. It feels like a good fish, that. Like I said, 5 pound mainline. You can just hear me shock leader now going through your eyes, so you know you're near enough netting distance now. It's fighting well, look at that. Oh yes. Oh baby. It's not one of the big ones, but it's probably 3 pound looking at that. Just want to get him in the net. Look at that. Stunning. Cool, yeah, £3 that at least. So I'm just gonna wind, put my anti-reverse on. Make sure everything's nice and neat. Look at that, for a Shatterford bream. Absolutely stunning. Just hooked in the bottom lip. You know, that changed, probably £4, at least that. That's probably near on £5. I thought it was £3, but lifting that up, that's probably £5. Absolutely bang on. Well, I'm just gonna go through how I do my shock leader. Now I've got a 5 pound sinking mullet there, and I think that's really important. One, I can get the distance when I cast, and two, it gets the line down a lot quicker. If I was to use 8 pound straight through, it'd be a lot harder. So first thing I do, this is me line, me main line, 5 pound. So I don't tie the loop in me shock leader, I tie the loop in my 5 pound main line. So all I do is tie a loop, just a figure of eight knot to make the loop. And I have the loop roughly about 2 inches long. It doesn't matter that much, as long as it's about 2 inches, like that. Make sure it's nice, make sure the knot's nice and tight. Just get a pair of cutters, nip that off really close, like that. So it's nice and easy. So my main line, 5 pound with a loop in the end. Doesn't get any easier. Now I've got my 8 pound shock leader, like that. So that goes through me loop, like that. Just gonna have to turn a little bit. And what I do then is basically, my shock leader's through the loop, I grab out of both times, and I go round 4 times. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's like a half turn blood knot. And then obviously I've twisted it round, and I go back through the bottom of the twists. Like that. Pull that down, and you get to a stage where it's nearly now on the loop of my main line. So just pull that down a little bit more, just lubricate it, and then just give it a good tug like that. Always have the loop in your main line, and then the half turn blood knot is on the shock leader. So once that's all nice and tight and neat, pair of nail clippers, nip that off, sort of leave like half a mil like that. And obviously that's the way I do my shock leaders. Everybody does it different ways and different knots, but for me, that's the easiest. It's never let me down. I've never had it catch in the eyes. It's just job done, simple as that. Well, I've cast that again. Like I said, it's getting that first bite, and it's only literally been out there probably between 5 and 10 minutes. And another bite, it's actually gone round and sort of flicked back. This feels like a right dog, this thing. And like I said, it's 20 odd foot deep, this lake. You know, using that 8-pound shot leader, you know, you're casting a long way. It just gives you that confidence of casting out, not snapping off. Just get concentrate on this a minute. There's just hear me shock leader going into the eyes now. Ooh, that's fighting well. I mean, that rod's absolutely bang on for this. It didn't look that big, that last one in the water, but when I got it out, it was probably 5 pound. Look at that. Ooh. A bit smaller, that one, but absolutely beautiful. I said double maggot, amazing. I sat on that air rig corn, but that don't mean to say that, you know, in a bit I might go back out on that air rig corn. Look at that. I could come here every day of my life. Probably, I would have thought that's probably 3.5 pound at least. Absolutely stunning. Let's get back out and get another one. Well, I've had a couple of big bream. It took probably 45 minutes for me to get a bite, and I expected that, to be honest. With the, you know, obviously with the water being that cold and that deep, it was always going to be hard at the start especially. But I've put 20 feeder falls in at the start with some corn, with some micro pellets, but I've put nothing else in because I really want to try and catch quality. But in the last sort of 15 minutes, I've had a couple of roach. So I'm just going through the motions really. I've got some micros. I'm putting like 2 or 3 bits of corn in. And if I do start catching lots of roach, I might even try air rig corn again, but I'm sticking with it. I'm either fishing with 2 maggots or 3 maggots on a 16-4-1-2. I've got a smaller feeder on. When I started, I put a big feeder on to get some bait out there, but I'm fishing like a medium distance cage at the moment, and I'm putting my ground bait in quite hard. And that's the sort of thing I do when I'm fishing. I go from, if I'm not catching, I'll put it in a bit softer so it makes a bit of cloud, but I'm really plugging that like quite hard. So it goes to the bottom, because I want them fish to come to that feeder, because obviously if they're on your feeder, they're near your hook bait. I don't want millions of particles coming out, especially in this depth of water. But if I was fishing a different venue, catching roach, I might only give it a quick squeeze. If I go to Porth Reservoir, for instance, when I'm fishing for skimmers and roach there on the drop, because a lot of the fish there want to come off the bottom. No one knows why, but they're really awkward sometimes to keep them down. And I'll just give my feeder a little squeeze. But at the moment, so I'm just filling that up with ground bait, with a few micros in it, 2 bits of corn, and giving it a right good squeeze. Well, I missed a couple of bites, so I shortened my hook length down to about 18 inches. I've just cast that, it's at the bottom. I was just tightening down to the feeder, and straight away I've got one. I think it's a decent roach. And like I said, it took an hour and a half to start catching, but you expect that, you know, with the water temperature being so cold. But like I said, it's all about getting that first bite. Feels like a nice roach. Oh yeah, it's kicking a bit, that. But that rod's perfect for this, you know, even if you're catching roach, skimmers, big bream. That is proper kicking, that thing. And just, that's the good thing about having that shock leader. You know, when that shock leader goes in your eyes of your rod, you're getting close to where you're gonna net the fish. Oh yeah, look at that for a roach. Stunning. So the little things, you know, once I started getting a few indications, shorten your hook length a little bit. If you're missing bites, shorten it down. And look at that for Shatterford roach. Don't get better winter fishing. Brilliant. Just double maggot, double dead maggot. And I'll just run you through what I'm doing again. So keep your back wind on, because when you're like loading your feeder and you're hooking up, if you have your back wind off, you start getting, you know, you start doing this, you're getting a bit of a tangle, have your back wind on, keeps everything nice and tight through the ice, you don't get tangled. If you get tangled around your tip, that's when your tips get snapped. So just keep everything tight. So double maggot, just hooking one way and then through the other. I'll say then just putting me bait in the feeder really hard. Just a few micros in there, odd bit of corn, really compacting the feeder and give it a real good squeeze, you know? Because I want them fish to go down to the feeder. Get that out, I'm giving, you know, I'm fishing out quite a way, hits a clip, get the rod down below the water, and it's mega deep. You know, I can just feel the line. I always do that, I've done that for years. I just feel the line and wait for the tension to come off, because then I know the feeder's at the bottom. So it's still on its way down, hits the bottom there. Give it a quick strike to try and get the line down, and immediately I start winding. And I try, because if someone takes that as it settles, I want to be able to see it. So I keep winding, keeping a little bit of tension in the tip. So like I said, if anything takes the bait, you'll see it. I just keep winding, so I'm just trying to get the line down tight to the feeder. It's obviously taking some time because it is mega, mega deep. And if I'm getting lots of bite, sometimes I'll have the rod on my lap. So instead of having it on like a bank stick and then my rod hold all there, I'll actually have it on my leg. So I'm doing it like that, but I'm not getting loads of bites at the moment. So I'm quite happy just having the rod like that. It's nice and comfortable. I've got my butt rest all made up, ready. And it comes to a stage where sometimes you think, well, how long have I got to leave it out? I mean, at the start, I was leaving it out, obviously, for, you know, quite some time. I put a bed of bait in. I was sat on it, waiting, and all of a sudden it went round. I caught that 5-pound bream. Then I caught one just after. I've not caught any since, but I think on a deep venue like this, I think they sort of come into your peg, a couple of them feed. And a lot of the time, I think on these big, deep waters, the bream come off the bottom, and you just swim around, and then now and again they'll go back down again. So I'm just going to tighten that up a bit. I just want a little bit of a bend in my tip, not too much. Like that. Just so it's just like nice. So I'm just watching my tip now, just keep watching it. I mean, that bite come really quick. And it's hard work on a deep venue like this. It's hard, you know, when you're getting lots of bites, it's, you know, your feeder takes quite a few time, you know, probably somewhere between 10 and 12 seconds to go down. So you can just imagine, if you're catching lots of fish, it's quite hard work. But it's really enjoyable. There's a little tiny knock then. And I'm, you know, what's going through my mind at the moment, do I start putting some casters through or do I start putting some dead maggots through? There's a little indication then. There you go. I think that feels like another route. So I just left that. Not sure what that is, not very big. But I've got, you know, I've got to come a long way. I'm probably fishing like 70 turns there of this 5,000 reel. And I just keep a nice little tension on it. Always, you know, I don't really pump it. When I'm playing a little fish, I sort of use the rod a little bit, but use the reel. But you want to keep them coming. You don't want to go slack at all, especially with barbless hooks. And if I think it was a good fish, the first thing I'd do is take me back wind off. But I know this ain't a big one, so I'm just going to keep it on. Another roach again, I think. There's me shot leader gone through. A nice roach. Look at that, lovely fish. Only 5 ounces. As you can probably tell, I've got the rod on me leg at the moment because I am now starting to catch roach. So having it on me knee, that feels like a good fish. don't think it's a skimmer, I think that's another big roach. So having the rod on my leg, I can control what I'm doing a lot quicker. It might be a hybrid or something like that. So I've gone from sort of sitting there with the rod on me butt rest, you know, waiting for a bite. And once I start getting bites, I've transferred the rod up onto my leg. I can cast out, wind down to the feeder a lot quicker. It saves a lot of messing around. And I'm holding the rod, especially when you're getting roach bites. I'm just going to take your backwind off of that because it feels like a decent sized fish. Like I said, I'm keeping my rod eye because I am dragging them up this shelf. But I've still not put nothing through, just ground baiting micros. Oh, that's nodding, look at that nodding. Let's hope it's a big roach. Just got to go careful because I'm fishing a 30 gram feeder, and the heavier feeder you use, especially with barbless hooks, they can sort of flick and come off. So just take your time, get your net ready. Oh yes, I think that's a nice hybrid that. Oh no, it's a big roach. I need me book of fish. Look at that, stunning. Look at that. Shatterford roach, don't get any better than that. Stunning. Not changed anything. Apart from, just had me hook length a little bit shorter than what I was using at the start. Double maggot. I've tried three maggots. Double seems to be the best. I don't think them bream are there. I think I caught them two big bream. And I think, honestly, I really think if the bream were in me peg, especially the size of what they've been, the roach probably would just fade away. So just took two bits of corn, a few micros in. Like I said, compact it. Nice little distant cage. Really easy to cast. Give it a proper whack with that 8-pound shot leader. That's the nice with an 8-pound shot leader is nothing can go wrong. You know, but that 5-pound main line helps you get out where you're casting, and I think the presentation's better. You can get your line down quicker. It's just easier to work with. You give that a little flick like that, and it'll start winding like that. So I got a little bend in the tip. Because with roach fishing and skimmers sometimes, maybe not with bream, but with smaller fish, they'll have that hook bait really quick. So I got it on my leg and I just keep winding, just keep that little bend in the tip. There we go. I think I've missed that. But that's roach fishing on the feeder, you know. You're gonna miss a few. Bit annoying because I'm fishing a long way out and I've got to drag that feeder all the way back. So just cast that again. Give that a proper whack as I am fishing out quite a way. It's a clip, straight down, follow it in. And like I said, you can either watch the tip or do what I do, is just hold the line like that and then wait for it to go slack. So the feeder's just at bottom, quick flick, straight on your rod rest and start winding. And just keep that little bit of bend in the tip. And hopefully if a roach nails that, you've got a better chance of hooking it. And that's what can happen, you know, it takes a long time to get your first bite in the winter. You might get some bream, or you might just catch roach. I mean, I've put a good bed of bait down at the start. There you go. So I just kept winding, just kept a little bit of bend in the tip. Just keep winding. Little roach. Good practice as well, you know, come to a place like Shatterford, catching roach on a feeder, it's brilliant practice. if it was a little bit shallower, if it was like, I mean, this is probably, you know, this is exceptional how deep this lake is, but if you were going to a lake which is what I would call normal depth, like 6, 7, 8 foot, then you could, you know, if you're a catching roach, I'd probably put me ground bait in a lot, you know, compact it a lot less, so it was coming out on the drop. But when you're fishing in really deep water, just go careful, because they'll be so far off the bottom, you won't catch. So good whack, hits a clip, straight down. So get your rod down as much as you can. And sometimes if I'm fishing catching roach on the drop, and I know what count it is, if this goes slack before the count, I know there's a roach on, or something's effect, you know, something's nailed the bait on the drop. So I just start winding immediately like that. So I've got the same bend in it as I would if I was just waiting for a bite. And as the line gets tighter to the feed, you just slow down on the reel a little bit just to keep the same bend in the tip. So I'm getting now, it's starting to catch up with the weight of the feeder, so I just slow down a bit. Just slow him right down now, there we go. So just as that was sort of getting to the stage of being tight with the feeder, I've just had a little bite then. Like I said, this rod, you know, but with these fish, with these roaches, it's really important that you keep just a nice tension on. Use the reel to play the fish, rather than when I was fishing for the bream, obviously, it was a bit different because they were a lot bigger. Oh, that feels like a better roach. There's a shot lead gone in, so I know I'm near now netting distance. Lovely, don't get better. Hit that. Showroom condition roach. And if I was in a match situation, I mean, I've had them couple of bonus bream, I'm now getting bites regularly. I'm still putting micros in, still putting the odd bit of corn in. So if I wanted to, I could try a bit of corn on, especially, you know, later in your match or your pleasure session. And I could sit there and fish for another bonus bream. But I think, personally, if them roach are in your peg like that, I think the bream have either come off the bottom or they've just sort of shut up shop. And that's fishing, you know. Like I said, I've put a bed of bait down. I've put the right bait in, I think, which was fish meal ground bait in micros. And add them to big bream. And then the roach have just, you know, the roach have switched on. And I'm quite happy. I'll be quite happy, you know what I mean? Quite happy just plodding along. You know, they're nice roach. Apart from that little perch. But, you know, I'm not putting particles in. I'm not putting loads of casters in. I just feel now, when them roach have settled over that ground bait and those micros, I don't want to go and put a load of casters and stuff in. I'll probably end up missing loads of bites. Roaches, like I said, roaches are really difficult to catch on a feeder. It can be really frustrating. You miss lots of bites. It's hard work because you're in and out all the time. But that's, you know, that's feeder fishing. Well, I've had an absolute cracking day here at Shatterford. I've caught some lovely fish. It's been absolutely brilliant. I'm going to put them back now. I bet you've got some nice little tips on how to do a bit of feeder fishing in the winter. Let's get them back. Look at that. It don't get better. The water is absolutely freezing. I mean, the bream were there at 1 minute and then they were gone, but I've caught some fantastic roach. Like I said, not easy to catch. Look at them beauties. Absolutely stunning. There you go. Everyone's a swimmer, and I'll see you on the bank sometime.